Okay, I'm going to quickly go over how to set up and use zclimate, which is a front-end program for running Zcash D wallet with a little bit more ease. As you can see, we've got Zcash D 532 here, and we're synced. We're on Lubuntu 22. This was built and tested on Ubuntu 20, but Lubuntu is the same thing, and this device isn't really that fast, as you can see here. We've only got two logic threads, so I'm not going to open up the browser. I'm just going to do it all from right here. First of all, you're going to need iNotify wait, which you can install with the sudo apt install iNotify tools. Now, I've already got it, so nothing is going to happen here. And then also we're going to need Rust, which you can install. I've already got it installed. I'll just show you. I've got the latest. And then we're going to need to clone into zclimate. Git clone, https, github.com, autotunefish, zclimate. Now you can do this into your downloads folder if you want, and then name the binary here in just a minute, zclimate. But we'll just name the binary climate, so there's no name problems there. Now, let's see. We're going to create a new cargo here as well. We're going to call it climate, like I just said. Cargo. Okay, just like that. You can call it whatever you want, but I'm going to call it climate. All right. And let's bring up the file explorer because it's easier this way. I'm just going to show you how we do it this way. Alright, so zclimate is what we downloaded. We have to set some permissions and move some files around here because it doesn't do it automatically. First, we'll move our Rust files. Cargo.toml and main.rs. Okay, copy. You can cut it. Might just be easier. I'll just go ahead and cut it, and so that way it's not here when we come back. And we're going to go into our binary we just made, climate, and we're going to replace the cargo toml and the main overwrite. Main into the src folder and overwrite the main that's already in there. Alright, that's it. Now we need to go back to zclimate and we're going to add permissions for all of them except for the readme and the git. Okay, we need to add read and write permissions for all of them. Okay. And then specifically, climate notify scripts here, debug script, climate use 5, climate use Knox 5, excuse me, climate use Knox 3, and climate use Knox 1. Okay, permissions. Clicked the wrong thing here, sorry about that. But gosh dang it, what are you doing here? Alright, make the file executable. Now again, let's move this out of the way. Climate notify scripts, debug script, climate use Knox 5, 3, and 1. Make executable. You can actually just select all of them, add permissions to all of them, and that'll work. But that's kind of, you know, a little out there. But it does work. That's what I did when I was testing it. Alright. Now we'll select all of them, copy them. We'll need to cut them this time. Well, we'll cut them. Yeah, let's cut them. Why not? Cut. Now we're going to place them into the Zcache SRC folder. Okay? So I can see anything. Actually, let's just go back. Right click, paste. There we go. go back and see something. As you can see, there they are. Climate notify, no 1, 2, NOx. Climate use 0, 1, 2. Climate use NOx 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Now, we have to start our scripts. So, I'm going to open, we're going to open actually three new tabs here. 1, 2, 3. Now, why three new tabs? Well, we're going to run the scripts individually. There is the one script. Excuse me, bring it back up here. Where did I move it? Dang it. Oops. Debug script. Excuse me. This one has to go into our .zcache folder. Sorry about that. This one actually isn't even used in the program, so, oops, it doesn't matter. You don't even have to use this one if you don't want to, but it just kind of makes seeing the output a little bit easier. .zcache, and we're just going to paste. Here we go, and I will demonstrate this one at the end. Okay, now. Okay, in each terminal, we're going to go to src, and we're going to run each climate notify script, climate notify. Sorry guys, it's early. One. And two. All right, now. Okay, those are running. Now. The bash script, let me go back here, that we put in called climate notify NOx is actually a convenience script that will run all three of those scripts at the same time. I'll just open it up and I'll show you. But like I said, as you can see, climate notify 1 and 2, and then in wait, it just keeps going over and over. I don't know about the performance difference, but I did try it and it does work. So if you just want to run this one script, then it might work for you. Okay. Now they're all going. Zcache is going. Let's build the binary. Okay, so cd. Oops. Climate. Cargo run. That's it. Now we wait. Okay, now this node only has just one, I think, receive transaction in it, and will create another account and some more addresses and do some test transactions. But when we call the transaction history, list receive, stuff like that, it's not going to show us a whole lot. On the device that I programmed it on, it had hundreds of transactions from the old Zcash VR magazine. If you remember that, it was about 287. It was pretty wild. All right, so here we go. Let's bring it full screen. This is what you get prompted with. Now, you're going to have to enter three paths, and they all have to be exactly right. Otherwise, this isn't going to work. This is the only time, like when during the execution of the program, where you're going to have to do this, is in the beginning, but they have to be correct. the path to your configuration file. Okay, it could be wherever you want it to be. But mine lives in home, leading forward slash home, John, me. Now the default location is inside of the .zcache folder, as you can see, but mine lives here. We want the path to the zcache src folder, okay? If you're running zcached, you ought to know, See, there you go. And now the path to the debug log. That's the .zcache folder, same place where we put the debug script, okay? But we need the path to the log file itself. So forward slash home dot zcache slash debug dot log. Okay. And the reason we need that is so that we can fetch the transaction history if we need to. Let's see if we got anything. Yeah, there you go. Now get info basic. It only cleans up some of it. So let's do the next one. Show transaction history. Help. All right. Actually, we have no. Oh, hang on. There you go. Sometimes zcached is slow. I forget. We've only got two logic threads here. So actually, I would like to add a little print line that says, please wait. There, you'll see it later when we do some of the other ones. Because, yeah, sometimes it'll wait. Let's try that one again. All right. So if we want to list received by two, this one has a couple of received. We'll hit number two. As you can see, the number that correlates 1, 2. Enter. We get our transaction ID, the amount, the memo, message. There you go. And the block time. Now this is parsed from the epoch timestamp, which is why it has to use the chrono crate. Let's see. All right. All addresses. We'll come back to wallet. Wallet contains the send function. All addresses, A, lists all your addresses and your receivers. Okay, you can't send from the receivers. You can't get the individual balances for the receivers, but you can see them. And we could theoretically get the private keys if we wanted to, but there's no tooling for the keys in here yet at all. All right, let's make a new address for, we'll make a new account. We'll just go right down the line. We've only got one account. Actually, yeah, let's do new account. We'll see. Existing accounts, 0. Now, you have to enter Y in order to create the account. If you hit enter anything else, it doesn't do it. So we'll do new account, and we'll enter Y. Let's get a new account. All right, account 1. Now, if we go to our wallet, it lists all our accounts and our addresses eventually. There it goes. Now, on a faster machine, this is much faster, trust me, usually. Now, we can select number 2, okay, or we can select 1. We can see the balance for number 1, 0, the balance for number 2, 0, the receiver types for this address. When we select the address, and we got like the total at the bottom there, select the address, we will get our receivers, the balance, checks whether or not we have enough funds to send. Here, we'll go ahead and push S to spend. We won't send anything just yet, because I want to create another address and account to send to. Here, we'll paste in here. We'll just put in this guy. Well, we'll just put in here. Doesn't matter. We'll try another one here in a minute. Enter. Verifies. Address is valid. If it wasn't valid, it would have said invalid. Enter the amount to send. It's not verified. Part of the reason is because of the way that it's programmed. But basically, at this point, you need to enter the amount that you actually want to send. But if you type in the wrong amount, like it'll kind of go through. However, before we actually send, we'll see it, cancel it if we want, and then if we don't, it's not like it's going to execute anyways. So, no big deal. Enter the memo. Well, whatever. Okay, memo, whatever, from that address to that address, the wrong amount. Now, here again, we have to hit Y, specifically capital Y, to send. We don't want to send, so we're going to cancel that. Now, let's get a new address first so that we can send between the accounts. Now, let's get a new address for account number one. And let's get a full UA, why not? You can select whatever type of UA that you want. We'll create, like I said, number one, full. And there we go. Just the raw output on this, your address, and your receiver types. If we go into addresses, we can see, there it is, right here, with our receiver types. And if we go into the wallet, once Zcash D decides to come along here, there we go. Okay, now let's send some funds. Wait, we don't want to enter this. We want to enter two. The address we want. S to send. Receiver address. We'll use our brand new UA that we created. Now we could get the receivers of it and send to a particular receiver if we wanted to, but it doesn't matter. Now actually, we'll fail the address here. We'll delete that one letter. Actually, let's replace that letter with a different letter. Let's see what happens. Oh, it's invalid. All right, let's try again. Two. Capital S to send. Receiver address. Okay. Now also, it can contain the quotation marks. Like, it's going to basically remove any quotation marks that exist here. So even if you have just one quotation mark, like you copied it, but you accidentally grabbed that one, it'll be okay. Valid. All right. Amount to send, we're cheapos. Let's send nothing. And then let's do a test transaction. For example, video. Okay, that'd be good, I suppose. Amount zero, okay. We're ready to go. Enter Y to send. Now, when it sends, we're gonna get our op ID. Uh-oh, I didn't do it right. Oh, it didn't actually remove the quotation mark. We're going to have to fix that. Yeah. Okay, so that was my fault. I'll fix that. Let's try this again. Check that the address was right, but it didn't actually remove the quotation mark. Thank you. Valid. Very good. Like I said, we're on the slow machine, guys. Okay. All right. I'm not expecting it to fail this time. Okay. Operation ID. We hit O. This lists them. It doesn't remove them, but it lists them. Executing. All right. Let's give it a second here. A couple of seconds. It ought to be done by now. Success. Very good. All right. Now, C, Z, get balance. That's just a basic paste in the address. Get the balance. Now, this may not be, now, this may not actually, like, give us our updated balance just yet. Let's just grab one here just to test. Okay. Oops. Oh, yeah, I'm recording this on a capture card. I just accidentally knocked the wire. That's why it went all jiggy like that. All right, so that was which address was it? That was the from address, right? Yeah, okay. Let's just go back to our wallet. I think we just have to wait for it to update. Let's see. No, let's see. Nope. And then we just have to wait. All right, well, I guess while we wait, just get all the transactions. This may take a few minutes. Yep, because it's going to go through the entire debug log. Why? All right. Let's see. What time is it? Current time is 8:55. I don't think you can see it on your screen. That's all right. We'll just let it go. It's going to take a few minutes, and then by then our balances ought to be updated. Check that again. Yeah. It only handles one address. So once this is done, we'll run it again. Like I said, this is all very beta. on the GitHub anyways. There's no persistent memory with this program. It's not going to write these transactions into a file to use them later. Every time it calls these things, balance, amounts, stuff like that, it's doing it live. Let's make sure that Zcash view is still going. Of course it is. It's going just fine. All right. Oh, cool. It's done. Here we go. All right. One. This is that first one we showed. And then two. TX test Y wallet value Zippo example. Let's see if it does it correct. The balance. There it is. Just had to wait for it to update. Very good. Okay. Here we go. And so we've sent. What are we gonna do now? Let's create another address. Let's create a different one. Another one for account one. Let's create a transparent and sapling 4. Here we go. PPZ sapling transparent. Excuse me. Let's make another send. And not purposefully mess it up this time. Let's send to this address number 4. Oh, I didn't. See, the reason I put these in here is to keep you from accidentally making transactions that you don't want to do. And I think I need to put some print lines to kind of lift these lines up away so that we can see them a little better. We'll send a transaction fee so that the address can make a transaction. We'll do that. Send. Okay, next. Test. Sorry. All right. Now, like 4, we're going to give it just a few seconds to execute here. The other one took like 18 seconds, I think that it said. Failed insufficient funds. Privacy policy isn't right, or is it right? Let's see. Okay, well, I guess it failed. So there's the thing with sending to certain types of receivers. So we'll just send from 2 to 3, which will definitely work. I put in like 0001 last time. I might have done that. That would have been a mistake. God only knows. We gotta watch and find out later. What's going on here? Is it okay? Whoa, what happened? There we go. Gonna have to adjust the default privacy policy, I suppose. I think right now it's sent to just allow revealed amounts. So, let's try one more time. Let's just send to a sapling address. You know what? Here, yeah. Let's just here get my addresses. I didn't want to paste it. Dang it, doesn't matter. That time. Oh, the little things. I'm gonna have to adjust my privacy policy. That's maybe give you the option to select the one that you want, but right now it just puts in allow revealed senders. Success. All right. Thank you. Now, if we wanted to get all the transactions again, we could do that. But we'll just go ahead and show RX history for what? What did we just send that one to? Three or four? I can't remember. That was three. Maybe it hasn't gone through yet. Because we may not even have any spendable funds. Yeah, see, we don't have any spendable funds right now because it hasn't finished yet. But, yeah, I think I'm going to go ahead and stop the video. It's getting kind of long. Interesting little thing there we went through with the send bit. But, like I said, this is a work in progress. I'm going to look at that. yep. All right. Talk to you guys next time. Oh, and before I forget, the debug script. Let me show you how he works. Excuse me. We go into... Let's create a new tab here. Sorry. And we'll go into our .zcash folder. And then we're going to run debug script. First thing it does is it echoes out the last 10 lines of the wallet debug log. Excuse me. And as you can see, These add to wallets are the transactions that we just executed. We can see the TXID 43D134. Problems, guys. All right, there it is. Sorry about it. Okay, here we go. All right. Let's get our all transactions. All right, we'll just do the operations. It's faster. Transaction ID 43D134. So as you can see, you can just basically just watch the debug log just kind of go as it goes. And every time that a new line process new block, typically it's the most common one that it adds, you'll see this little debug log modify. See, there you go. All right.